The bleeding wounds of Christ have mysteriously appeared on a rare group of people. St. Paul is often said to have been the first to show this fascinating phenomenon. In Galatians in the Bible, he is quoted as saying, "I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus." The Greek for marks is stigmata. Whether Paul's stigmata were meant literally or symbolically is ambiguous, but the word stigmata has come to be known as the mysterious wounds which mirror those that Christ suffered on the cross. They may be round holes in the hands or wrists, the feet, on the side, on the head, or may be shaped in the sign of the cross. A stigmatist may exhibit some or all of these. Who are the stigmatists? And what is the nature of their strange markings? In Glasgow, in Scotland, one man has stigmata wounds that usually bleed once a week. Like most stigmatists, George Hamilton is a devout Roman Catholic. He also shares a problem that some stigmatists have. He is unable to eat solid foods. George has to be fed through a drip feed in his nose. His doctor, John Spence, recalls the first time he saw the wounds.
What he did was he took his gloves off and showed me his hands. They weren't covered, there were no bandages on. He had these marks in his hand. He'd just take these gloves off, and it was the first time I'd seen these things at all. I've been looking for something unusual about George for some time, having known him for some years before. I've always felt as if there's been something missing from his story, but this is something unusual.
Not too bad. Right, what can we do for the day?
Your prescription.
Right. Can you take it off? Do you want me to take it off?
Huh?
On you go. You tear my hair off. Oh my gosh, right.
It's still running.
Yeah. It's still running. That's worse than the first time, eh?
Mm-hmm.
Still going on. Any other spots come up? I know the other hand, but has there been any other points since I saw you?
Just a bit in the sides.
Right.
Don't think I really showed you that.
No, I haven't seen that before. He has told me on more than one occasion that he really doesn't want this. He would quite like it to go away because too much hassle attached to it.
George's marks seem to have no medical explanation. Skeptics wonder if the marks are not self-inflicted.
I've known him for a long time now. I don't think that someone would do this in such a way, in such a repeated way. It'd be quite difficult, but it certainly is possible you could do it yourself. In knowing George and spent time not only in the surgery with George, but even took him out for a coffee outside the surgery context and got to know him quite a bit. Yes, I think I don't see George as doing this to himself at all.
George recognizes he is asking people to take a leap of faith in believing him.
Well, there's no way I can be sure. I just have to take my word for it, and I've got to rely on God that He gives me the strength to carry on.
For many in the Catholic Church, there is no surprise that God makes His presence felt through the flesh.
The fundamental, the point of departure, the proposal of the Christian reality, the Christian faith, is that divinity became flesh. So the manifestations of divinity are going to be manifestations in the flesh, in human flesh, in the human reality.
The stigmatic wounds vary from case to case in their severity. None is more shocking than those of Giorgio Bongiovanni from Italy. Giorgio was a 26-year-old shoemaker visiting the famous Catholic shrine at Fatima in Portugal when his wounds first appeared in September 1989. At first, it was just his hands. But over the following years, wounds appeared on his feet, his side, his forehead, and most bizarre of all, he appears to weep tears of blood. He bleeds at least once a week, and the wounds can appear in weird shapes of hearts and crosses. When Giorgio bleeds, he claims he can see and feel Christ's suffering. Giorgio agreed to let hematologists take samples of blood from his wounds for testing. The results showed that his blood was healthy, with normal clotting times and no signs of infection. Doctors remain mystified. Giorgio's story is not unique. The stigmata phenomenon has been found worldwide. Early in the 20th century, the tiny rustic Bavarian village of Konnersruth became famous as the home of a stigmatist. She was Teresa Neumann. She had wounds on her hands and feet and in her side. But most dramatic of all was the blood streaming down her face, as seen in this rare color footage. Teresa's wounds bled on most Fridays, and like many stigmatists, she would go into trances. In her visions, she is said to have witnessed Christ's crucifixion from the beginning to its end. To observers, Teresa seemed to share in his suffering. Other miraculous claims are made about Teresa. She is said to have survived for years only on communion hosts. In her trances, she is said to have heard and repeated the Aramaic language spoken directly by Jesus. Pilgrims from all over Germany and beyond flocked to Konnersruth to see Teresa. For many, she was revered as a living saint. For them, here was physical evidence that confirmed their faith in God. Teresa Neumann had her stigmata for 36 years until she died in 1962. Cases like Teresa's arouse the interest of an Englishman who has traveled the world in search of stigmata. He is acknowledged as the world's leading expert on the subject. His name is Ted Harrison.
The thing that really interests me about stigmata is that it is a way of being able to understand the whole mystery of the miraculous. Here we see marks, physical marks, real blood, real wounds. They inspire awe and wonder. And if you look at the way in which the word miracle was originally written in the New Testament, there are several different words, Greek words, that are used. And miracle is the one English word that's used to translate all of them. Awe and wonder is one of the key ones. So yes, they create awe and wonder in the people who see them.
One of the first stigmatists that Ted studied was Jane Hunt, an otherwise ordinary woman from Derbyshire in England. She felt the mysterious marks on her hands were stigmata, which she believed gave her the power to heal others simply by touching them. Similar claims have been made by many stigmatists.
People don't come to me, they come to God. I pray that the Lord will use me as his instrument to take away what is not me. Take all the bad, because I'm not worthy to do this.
I carry a lot of their pain, and it helps me know how they suffer, which I suppose to me is a good idea. I can feel their suffering as well.
Every case of stigmata is different because it involves a different individual being marked in a different way. But frequently you find that good comes out of the overall experience.
Stigmatists are usually devout Roman Catholics. 21st century stigmatists, however, are coming from a wider range of beliefs. In Los Angeles, Maurice Rosley tells how her wounds began.
It started out like blisters, itchy and oozing, and that was for about a week. And then it began getting progressively worse as the time went by. It started on my feet and it just blossomed out.
Maurice links her stigmata with a vision she had.
I saw a cloud forming, and out of the cloud, a ladder was coming down. A lady started descending on the ladder. She was one of the most beautiful, beautiful beings. And she kissed me on my cheek. Looked at me and smiled and went back up and disappeared on the ladder.
When she describes her visions of figures coming down steps to greet her and so on, that's partly the sort of thing you'd expect of a Catholic visionary. You know, the Virgin Mary being seen, Jesus coming to you. But it's also what you are now coming to see in some of the descriptions that are given of the abductees, who say, this alien came down from this strange craft and down the steps and marked me and so on. And you've got one or two cases of stigmatists who've actually said, you know, we were marked by aliens as opposed to Christ or God or an angel or whatever.
The mythology of stigmata may change with the times, but its roots can be traced back to medieval Europe and to an extraordinary man. There are no records of stigmata until the 13th century. Then here in Italy, the most famous case in history took place. Saint Francis of Assisi displayed wounds on his hands and feet, which the faithful believed to be a miracle from God. Every year, on the anniversary of his stigmatization, people gather to commemorate it. A religious relic of a bandage, still red with the blood of Saint Francis, is carried around the ancient town. Francis was born into a wealthy family in 1181 in Assisi in Italy. He turned his back on the comfortable life he could have had for one of extreme poverty and hardship. He felt the church had grown rich and materialistic and had become remote from ordinary people. Francis lived in this cleft in the rocks and felt his privations brought him closer to the true Jesus. His followers revered him almost as a second Christ. He was a frail and sick man, yet would fast for long periods. It was 4 weeks into one of his fasts here on a retreat at Mount Laverna that the miracle for which he is most revered happened. He was knelt, deep in prayer, when he saw a vision of a six-winged angel, a seraph, with the form of Christ nailed to the cross. At this moment, his followers believed he received stigmata. Friar Anthony McDowell has been a Franciscan friar for 40 years, taking a vow of poverty to follow in the footsteps of Saint Francis.
I think Francis, in his vision, saw the seraph, saw the six-winged seraph. I don't think there's any doubt about it. I think he saw the seraph. I think it is supernatural. The marks of Christ crucified in his hands, feet, and in his side. And one of the interesting things about Francis, when they examined them, the flesh had gathered in such a way that it looked like the head of a nail. It looked like the bent point of the nail in his hands and in his feet as well.
The stigmata mystery had begun. But why did it take until the time of Saint Francis to make its appearance? It coincided with a change in how Christ's crucifixion was perceived. Before the 13th century, Christ was usually shown on the cross with a placid expression and his eyes open as if preparing for his resurrection. Around the time of Saint Francis, the mood in Europe changed. Christ began to be portrayed on the cross in an agonized death. The bloody wounds began to be a prominent feature in paintings and statues as a symbol of his sacrifice.
Towards the end of Saint Francis's life, the dead Christ was by far the most popular image in European painting and sculpture. It would have been a very rare, conservative, and expensive commission to paint Christ live and triumphant.
In medieval Europe, the dead Christ on the cross became a powerful image to which ordinary people could relate.
It was easier for the great uneducated masses of the faithful to empathize with the suffering Christ, the sacrifice of Christ. Pain, of course, was an everyday factor of life, whereas the more abstract image of Christ alive on the cross was something that was intended in the first place to represent a theological dogma, and therefore accessible only to the educated elite.
News of Francis's stigmata quickly spread, but he was very protective about his wounds and kept them hidden.
The stigmata was not so much for public consumption. I think the stigmata was much more about the relationship of Francis with Jesus. It was his desire that he would in some way experience the suffering of Jesus. What was it like for Jesus suffering on the cross? What was that like?
Francis bore his wounds for 2 years until his death. He is venerated today as a saint, with his stigmata the most significant miracle of his life. Some people, however, are skeptical about the supernatural nature of his wounds and believe Francis may actually have been deranged.
It could well have been that he did it in some unconscious way to himself, but there's no way in which we can tell.
Author Joe Nickell has spent his life finding the rational answer to miracle claims. He has investigated the background to many cases of stigmata and is dubious about the St. Francis story.
When we talk about frauds and deceptions, most of us think of people doing something for crass motives and for personal gain, for money. But in fact, there's a whole category of what I called pious frauds, weeping icons, stigmata, miracle pictures that are, when we investigate these, look like they're fakes. But the motive may not always be money or self-serving, but may be to promote the faith. We certainly can look at St. Francis's life and see the life of a passionate convert who associated himself with Jesus and tried to become more and more and more intensively Christ-like.
Since Francis, there have been around 400 other cases of stigmata occurring. They have been different in many ways, but they all share one crucial aspect which fuels doubt about their authenticity.
Of the 400 or so cases in history, the very first marking, the very first moment, the very first stigmatization has never, ever been witnessed, as far as I can find, in any of the records. There have been many witnesses to the recurrence, the repetition of the marks, but nobody has ever observed the first time. And I think that is a significant fact.
But doubts didn't diminish the fame of the most celebrated stigmatist of recent times. He lived in San Giovanni Rotondo, a humble backwater town in southern Italy. He was Francesco Forgione, a member of the religious order founded by St. Francis. He became famous as Padre Pio. His stigmata appeared dramatically in 1918. He was praying alone in front of this crucifix when he cried out and collapsed to the floor. Padre Pio believed he'd had the pain of the stigmata for 3 years, but the wounds had been invisible until then. Now they were real. There is only one official photograph of his hands, which was taken after they were examined by doctors. They could offer no explanation for the wounds.
Somebody asked Padre Pio, "Does it hurt?" And he looked at them and said, "God did not give it me as a joke. It hurt."
Padre Pio never left his beloved San Giovanni Rotondo and carried his stigmata for 50 years. The local people treated him as a living saint as his fame quickly spread around the world. People would clamor to be at one of Padre Pio's masses. All dignity was cast aside in the rush to get a front seat. They would all try to be close to him and get a glimpse of his miraculous wounds. Padre Pio's local community were convinced his stigmata were the result of divine intervention. This was a physical sign from God. However, those coming to see the wounds would be disappointed. He only removed his gloves during communion and wore his sleeves long, hiding his wounds from view.
Obviously, when word got about that Padre Pio had the stigmata, then it became a source of great wonder, a sign of the miraculous, and a sign of God being there. So they may have come looking for the miraculous. They may have even come to mock and scoff and say, well, he's just dreamt it all up, or it's whatever. But at the end of the day, many of them went away, touched in some way, not simply by Padre Pio, but by God as well.
The Vatican was less enthusiastic about Padre Pio and was wary of his growing cult status. He tried to quell his popularity by only allowing him to perform Mass at 5 a.m. But to no avail, the crowds still came. The friar with the stigmata presented the church with a problem: to believe or to doubt.
The official Vatican position of stigmata is the recognition that it could be an authentic expression of a meeting with Jesus Christ, but that it need not always be, and therefore it's a great caution, like with any so-called miracle that people report. The church officially takes a long time in validating it, and even then it can only say that there doesn't appear to be any other explanation but that.
With doubts about the authenticity of Padre Pio's stigmata, the Vatican sent doctors to investigate the nature of his wounds.
The doctors who examined it were very detached and were quite cynical. You see reports coming through in medical reports to the Vatican. Well, these are lesions that were maintained by chemical means. They mention iodines and things like this. And I think that they had put their finger on one of the things that was going on, that I think Padre Pio was maintaining his marks using chemical means. It wasn't to defraud anybody. It was part of his pious prayer that he wanted to feel the pain of Jesus on the cross. It would have been a painful thing to do. But this, I think, is part of the explanation. He wanted to suffer with Christ, to suffer with the pain with Christ.
Padre Pio is said to have carried the stigmata for 50 years until his death. Even in death, mystery was not to leave him. Photographs of his body taken just hours after he died showed his skin to be unblemished by any wounds. The thought that Padre Pio was faking his stigmata is tantamount to heresy. For them, the disappearance of his wounds is further proof of the miraculous. He is revered, and an entire industry of memorabilia has grown to keep his memory alive. He was beatified by the church in 1999, the first step to becoming a saint. San Giovanni remains a beacon to the faithful who make pilgrimages there.
The numbers are building up every year of those who go to San Giovanni, not to see Padre Pio or to see the stigmata or the miraculous, because it isn't there, he's dead. But they go because here is a holy place. Here is God in some shape or form, slightly more powerful, if you will, than it would be in other places because of what has happened.
He brought a lot of people to a renewal of faith. This is often what happens with stigmata, that they become a focus of faith. That has no reflection, and there's no implication to be drawn from that as to how those marks came about, because they can come about in a variety of different ways, and I would suggest that none of those ways are supernatural.
For many, the most plausible explanation is that the stigmata are simple fakes made for a gullible audience. Tony Ewens in England exposes paranormal effects by reproducing them using trickery. We challenged him to use his skills to make stigmata appear before our eyes. to magically produce something from nothing.
Okay, first of all, I showed my hands would be empty. I'd pick up this and get your attention focused on this now. A rosary, which is quite acceptable for me to have. I could use this to bite into my hand and perhaps, you know, start a wound off that way. So they go, oh, look, there's the start of the stigmata, which isn't very impressive, but at least it starts it off. Remember, we're trying to get something from nothing here. Of course, on the other side, there's going to be nothing. You're not going to see anything on the other side of my hand, which is a problem. But once people have taken their eyes off me for a second, then I can start saying there's blood on my hand. Okay, on the centre of my hand, which is about where the wound was. I don't know if you can focus in on that. Now, on the other side, now I'd put in some time delay, and now I'd look, now it's just starting to seep through the skin here on the other side. As I'm doing this, I'm misdirecting you. An object for misdirection, I could either use it like that so I'm actually injuring myself, but also you're focusing on that. In the meantime, I'm getting this in my hand, a syringe. So now I go over and I point to it. Having done that, as soon as I'm turning over now, I've got this in my hand. As soon as I turn my hand over, then I squirt it in my palm and point to it there, and then lift it up to show you a bit closer. In the meantime, I've gone back and ditched the syringe. So that's how I would do it. But I mean, obviously, it's much simpler if people aren't watching. You've got some sort of cover. All I've got to do is that at some point, and it's over. It's much easier to do. You don't have to be an accomplished conjurer to do that. It's very, very simple.
Some other skeptics think it may be even easier to deceive observers who are willing to suspend their disbelief.
People trying to speculate on how stigmata might be faked often are too clever. They imagine too much and are too creative. The actual stigmata is often done by poorly educated peasant people who are not sophisticated and who may use something as simple as a sharp-pointed finger ring that would enable you to have a sharp object on your person in full view and no one would suspect it, and that would enable you to make a crisscross cut on your hand or a scratch here and there.
Many people are more ready to put their faith in the miraculous. In Boston, Massachusetts, a stadium of 10,000 pilgrims awaits the arrival of Audrey Santo. Audrey is a teenager who thousands of people believe has supernatural healing powers. She also has stigmata wounds on her hands. There is one aspect about Audrey that is unique among stigmatists. She is in a coma. Audrey has been unable to move or speak since a tragic accident when she was 3 years old. Her mother, Linda, believes Audrey's stigmata are real.
She's received the crown of thorns twice, which are very visible. And she's experienced the outward signs of the passion and the inward signs of the passion. Audrey's experienced all of those things in the past years, and her nurses have documented these things.
Inevitably, some people question the claims made about Audrey. Could her stigmata have a more rational explanation?
One of the plausible explanations could be that here's this little girl, she has muscle spasms and so on, whether she's marking her own hands with her fingers. And then what is seen is a mark in the hand, and her mother sees it or the faithful see it and read into that that this is the mark of Jesus.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that
at the service in her honor at the stadium, her supporters have no doubts about Audrey.
Her faith, her stepping out in faith has brought many, many souls to our Lord today.
I thought it was a wonderful ceremony. I think it was very prepared, and I'm glad that the family shared this for everybody.
And it was nice to be able to pray for her too, not just for us, for our needs, but for her, because you hope that she's healed one day.
At her home in Worcester, as Audrey lies in her bed, religious icons elsewhere in the house need collecting vessels to collect oil which appears to seep from them. Some believers say this is more evidence of the supernatural. Author Joe Nickel has investigated the case of Audrey Santo and is not convinced by the claims.
In the case of the weeping icons there are copious amounts of oil appearing on different icons and statues under conditions that I regard as very suspicious, because when the oil was tested. It was found in one instance to be 20% chicken fat, and it's done under conditions in which people don't see the flows actually originate, but they're always already taking place. They're already in action, as it were. And when people have asked to put up surveillance cameras, that's been refused.
Audrey's mother is not dismayed by the critics.
They're looking for anything that they can say this is a hoax. And the reason they want to do that is because once they realize it's real and it's the truth of the matter, they become responsible.
It's difficult to imagine the rationale of a divine being causing icons to exude olive oil mixed with chicken fat. The logic of this certainly escapes me. If we are to be given a sign, please let it be clearer, let it be less suspicious, please let it be under conditions that don't look like pious deception.
In Lincoln, England, is a small church.
For the contemptuous and scornful.
In 1992, Heather Woods, its deacon, began to display mysterious wounds.
And lead them to faith and obedience.
Just started as a little blister, and you know if you do painting or you're writing for a long time, and I just noticed it and I thought, oh, I wonder what I've done to get that. And I showed my friend and thought nothing more of it. And I said, oh dear, what's going to happen? You know, why me? I suppose the question we always ask. But then the next day, another blister appeared, and within 2 days, blister was on the tops of my hands, and these had started to weep.
When they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, did not break his legs. One of the soldiers pierced his side.
The bishop at Heather's church, Father Eric Eads, knew at once what the marks were.
She had this funny sensation in the palms of the hands, and I said to her before I went off to France, don't be at all surprised if you don't get the stigmata. Strange as it may seem, and it was exactly what happened, yes.
Father Eric had left his number, so I rang him. He was expecting the call. And I said, you're not going to believe it, Eric. And he said, your feet are breaking out, aren't they? I said, yes, you said they would. And he said, now it's beginning. It will come on underneath as well.
Within 3 days, Heather's wounds were complete. The stigmata were clear on the front and back of her feet and hands. Other strange things began to be associated with Heather. In a trance-like state, she drew religious images, and although right-handed, she wrote automatically with her left hand the thoughts and prophecies given to her by God.
I don't understand a lot of it. It's way above me. And Father Eric explains it sentence by sentence, and then I can see a little bit and I go, oh, yes. So, you know, Father Eric is... He's brilliant, really, in that he can translate it, if you like, into the terms that I can understand, all that it is, because a lot of this is for all Christians worldwide.
God is obviously giving us big signs at this moment in time, whether we're being told quite clearly to buck ourselves up and, you know, knuckle down and start to get on with one another, that could well be part of the answer.
Transient remorse.
Most merciful God, who by the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ...
For many stigmatists, Easter is particularly poignant. At this time, as they commemorate Christ's crucifixion, their wounds often make their clearest appearance. At the height of a service on Good Friday, Heather is very distraught. Earlier in the day, she had not been bleeding. Now, she was in great pain from her wounds. Stigmata expert Ted Harrison took a video camera to that service and asked to see the wound in Heather's side. He was surprised to find that the blood wasn't fresh, as if the wound had been made sometime before the service.
Seems to be fairly dry.
Yes.
As if it has been bleeding, but that it has dried. And it would be about 15 minutes ago, wouldn't it, since you felt the sharp pain?
I was just looking to see if...
Does it look different?
It does a bit, yes.
When we examined the wound in her side, that had got blood on it. Not blood that was that fresh that it could have come at the time that she was actually feeling the pain, but it was certainly blood that would have been there within an hour or two before.
To Ted, it seemed as if the wounds had been made some time earlier in the day.
The blood in your side, which seems to have been bleeding since we saw it this morning, was fairly dry. Now, same could it have been bleeding earlier and then you felt the pain afterwards?
It could have been, yes.
I think it has to be asked of Heather whether she was wounding herself. And I'm not saying that she was fraudulent, but I'm saying that she may well have been so wrapped up in her own religious life and her own prayer and her own desire to be suffering with Jesus that she could have sought the pain. There are some instances when stigmatics have got wounds in a natural way and have been unaware of how they did it. Heather, I suspect, would have been aware, but she wouldn't have been doing it in such a way that she would have wanted to deceive. It was to suffer the pain and the experience and the desolation of Christ more intently within the context of her visions and her automatic writing.
Had she been in any way a charlatan in that respect, I would most surely have exposed her. No.
What about just giving her the idea, you know, two fairly innocuous pimples that you gave her the idea?
Well, I thought that might be mind over matter idea, but she didn't even know what the stigmata was. She had no idea.
They gave wide their mouth at me.
Heather's story was to end in tragedy. Since this was filmed, her friend, religious advisor and supporter, Bishop Eric Eads, died of cancer. Shortly afterwards, Heather was found dead in a river. Heather has taken her secrets with her, and we shall never know for sure how her wounds were really caused.
Try American
ignorance of stigmata, and ones that don't rely on the supernatural.
I would say that they're not supernatural, most definitely not supernatural, for two reasons. One is that in the study I've made, I've come across no direct evidence of anything which has happened, which has been against the laws of nature. But secondly, I would argue theologically, it is not consistent with the Christian teaching of God that they are supernatural. Although there will be many people who will say, yes, God does perform miracles, I think one has to say that God performs miracles, if one believes in that, for a purpose. And it's very hard to find the purpose behind the Almighty doing this sort of party trick, if you like, zapping certain faithful with the marks.
One remarkable aspect of stigmata is that they often appear in the wrong place. Modern experts say medieval artists got the position of the nails wrong. The hands would not have been strong enough to bear the weight of Christ's body. He is more likely to have been nailed through his wrists. Could it be that these religious images have influenced where the stigmata appear? Could the wounds appear by natural means due only to the power of the mind? There is intriguing evidence from the medical world that may offer some clues as to how stigmata might occur. The British medical journal, The Lancet, in 1946, tells of a man who had been forcibly tied up. Years later, under hypnosis, the rope marks on his arms mysteriously reappeared. In another fascinating case, it was suggested to a hypnotized subject that a coin placed on her arm was hot. It wasn't. But as this film shows, over a period of several hours, a typical blister formed anyway.
An hour later, an hour and a half later, 2 hours later, and 3 hours, here is the blister complete.
Doctors can offer no explanation. Cases like this are rare. But could they offer clues to how the mind itself might produce stigmata? In Cleveland, Ohio, some patients develop mysterious bleeding or bruises on their body for no apparent reason. Marks would appear during periods of great emotional stress. Psychiatrist Dr. David Eagle was called to investigate.
The bleeding was not necessarily indiscriminate, where it would appear. That it often seemed to have some kind of symbolism, some meaning in the patient's life. There are people that are maybe very troubled by certain things in their lives, about events in the past or in the present that they're struggling with.
Dr. Agle called these mysterious marks psychogenic purpura, bruises that appear simply due to the effect of the mind on the body. He sees a link with stigmata.
When one reads about some of the people with the stigmata, some of them are described as in terms of called, quote, highly neurotic, multiple kinds of physical complaints that would be kind of typical of what we saw in our psychogenic purpura patients. They talk about trances, they talk about going into states of ecstasy and things of that kind, which may have some great similarities to what we do with our psychogenic purpura patients.
But could the very specific stigmata wounds actually appear this way? There is the extraordinary case of Elizabeth Kay. She was born in 1902 in southern Germany. She was a troubled child and regularly sleepwalked. Her limbs would shake, and she suffered headaches and paralysis, and was unable to eat or speak. In 1929, a psychiatrist, Dr. Albert Lechler, employed her as a servant in his home. He noticed that she seemed to take on the symptoms of other people's illnesses. She was shown slides of Jesus' crucifixion, and he was intrigued when she began to get severe pains in her hands. Under hypnosis, Dr. Lechler suggested a crown of thorns was on Elizabeth's head, and after an hour, several red marks the size of a pea appeared. His photographs of her show her with wounds on her hands and feet, and weeping blood-stained tears. But some people remain unconvinced.
If one analyzes the reports carefully, one has to conclude that the experiments were not as carefully controlled as they should have been. Hypnosis did take place, wounds did appear, but there was a time lag during which Elizabeth Kay could have produced the marks on her own hands.
The evidence is controversial, but for some, such psychogenic appearances of wounds offer a way of reconciling medicine with belief.
We as physicians have no way of saying there is not a strong theologic basis to many of the stigmatas. All we can say is we can see certain symbolism with some of our patients with psychogenic purpura that is important in their lives, their particular issues. That in no way is to imply that there is not a strong religious or theologic influence toward the production of stigmata in many patients, because that is beyond our level of investigation. We are just men.
Almost 800 years since St. Francis of Assisi, people still flock to commemorate what they see as the miracle of his stigmatization. Four 400 other cases later, stigmata are still an enigma. What can't be denied is the effect the phenomenon has had on believers, touched by what they see as direct evidence of God on earth.
I think what has happened in the past in trying to understand stigmata is people have asked the wrong questions. It's not, is this fraudulent or is this genuine? The skeptics say it must be fraudulent. The believers say it must be genuine. I think actually you've got to ask other questions. You've got to say, what is it doing? What is its purpose? What is its function? There is no one cause. It's caused in a variety of ways. Some are deliberate, some are not deliberate. All, I would suggest, are natural. But what happens as a result of the marks being seen is the important thing, because it can enhance faith. It is a genuine religious phenomenon.
There are many who will continue to be suspicious about the supernatural claims surrounding stigmata. But for others, their belief in the miraculous has been confirmed by these wounds. It is notable there have been more cases of stigmata in the last 100 years than at any time before. In our increasingly technological age, a medieval miracle lives on, capturing many people's imagination and keeping the flame of their faith alight.
This has been a presentation of the Discovery Channel and the BBC. $9.95 plus shipping and handling, you can stay on technology's cutting edge. Explore the world you've only imagined. Whether it's growing up or coming down, science unlocks the secrets within our world. Have this hour-long program delivered to your door. Call now to order, because there's no thrill like discovery.